Sir, they seem to have a new weapon.
A new weapon?
Look, a flaming spear!
That's just an insect glaive, son.
No, look again!
Wait, no insect.
No insect.
Do you think it's because of the fire?
What?
Well, maybe there used to be a kinsect there, but, you know, fire.
I don't think so, sir. I don't think so.
Ladies, gentlemen, and monsters of all ages, the demo for Monster Hunter Stories 2 Wings of Ruin is here. And by all accounts, this is just straight up the beginning of the full game, and your save will even carry over upon release. With this bountiful gift from the generous deities over at Capcom, we have so much to talk about. Not the least of which is just how excited I am to play this game as a whole. But putting that aside for just a few minutes to talk to you guys about something that I hope excites you, the weapons. More specifically, the general mechanics and feel of each of the 6 weapons in Monster Hunter Stories 2, Wings of Ruin, in the hopes of helping you choose which weapons to really sink your time into. Whether you are a Monster Hunter fan or just somebody checking out Monster Hunter Stories 2, Wings of Ruin, because it looks like a good time. Before I get into each individual weapon, and it's worth noting that in this game there are 3 damage types, with 2 weapons fitting in each damage type category. Greatsword and Sword and Shield are sharp weapons, or slashing weapons, Hammer and Hunting Horn are blunt weapons, Bow and Gunlance are piercing weapons. For some fights, you will have a significant advantage if you bring a blunt weapon. For example, some monsters are simply resistant to certain damage types, or something like Kula Yaku, who rips a rock in the middle of the fight out of the ground that is only weak to blunt damage. So, realistically, you want to be somewhat comfortable using at least one weapon from each category to be properly effective, rather than picking just one weapon and sticking to it as your main singular weapon the whole way through. In the same vein, you can switch weapons in the middle of a fight, meaning if you get good in the long term, you can definitely pull off some stylish weapon swapping combos in the thick of the battle. Now that we've covered that then, let's get into the weapons one at a time. Greatsword.
A sword. Oh, Archimedes, a sword.
Like every weapon in the game, the core principles are around the speed, technical, and power attack system. Nothing overly fancy there, however your animation for each is obviously unique to your weapon. Greatsword is a giant hulking beast of a weapon, a giant hunk of steel meant to be wielded by hunters both strong of body and strong of will. With this weapon, every swing will feel like it could be a finishing blow. Every attack that connects will leave you astonished that your foe is still standing. Once we get into the weapon skills is where things start to get a little bit more unique though. For Greatsword, your proper mechanic takes off, which is charge gauge blocks, essentially mimicking the way that the Greatsword in the action Monster Hunter games works. For the cost of some of your kinship, you can use a skill to either gain or spend these charge gauge blocks. You can only get to the second charge gauge block if you already have the first charge gauge block, and each spender does a load of damage. In some fights, you'll be able to use this to do some really fun and crazy burst damage, but for the most part, expect the way that Greatsword will feel to be big, hefty, lots of setup, but big payoff once you get there, just like the main series. Sword and Shield.
We've got to scatter them! Use the sword and shield maneuver!
This is one of the 2 somewhat defensive weapon types in the game, being one of the only 2 weapons with a straight-up shield, albeit a touch smaller than the shield of the Gunlance. However, when it comes to the shield, it's not the size that matters, it's the mentality, because you can guard just as well as that big ol' thing. This is arguably the simplest weapon in the game as of this point, nothing particularly unique going on, just a simple loop of use your abilities, which cost kinship, or use the kinship to ride. As far as the feel, this one is the fastest blitz of a melee weapon around. You want to slice and dice a monster before bonking it on the face? This is your fastest route to accomplish both of those. With this weapon, you can access your strongest kinship abilities really easily, just the soonest that you have the kinship gauge, as they're really quite cheap. But the trade-off is that they aren't particularly powerful. Thus, if you like to look cool as all hell and be cool all the time, but also have a defensive option, I think the sword and shield is a pretty damn strong option. For people trying to pick one of the 2 sharp weapons to use, the main thing to keep in mind here is big, chunky, and slow versus small, light, and fast. Greatsword has what essentially amounts to combos, where a sword and shield is much more reactive, with the defensive option as well. You can output a similar damage on turn 1 or turn 2 with the SNS as you can on turn 10. It has what it has, allowing you more options at any given individual moment. Then is Hammer.
It's hammer, go hammer, it's the hammer, yo hammer.
This is for the people who love the concept of the greatsword, but really just want to bonk something over the head with something blunt. To be blunt, this weapon is for the Neanderthals out there. Those of us who just want to give into their primal side and smash, and oh, it fills that role real well. It somewhat shares mechanics with the greatsword, as it also uses those charge gauge blocks. However, where greatsword can generate charge blocks by using certain skills, hammer literally cannot use a skill at all unless you have some charge blocks. On hammer, you get these by winning head-to-heads against your opponent, which is when you correctly predict their attack type and win the rock, paper, scissors. Get enough charge blocks and you can use one of a couple of big, really powerful meaty attacks. One particular uniqueness that I've seen so far is that some hammers come with the ability to capitalize hugely on statuses, coming with an attack that only costs one charge gauge block, and in return does extra damage to a creature that is affected by the status mentioned on the specific hammer. I feel like this right here is going to be the real reason to use hammer, if you care about having the most efficient team possible, at least, as you could build around using a bow, for example, to apply poison. Then switch to a hammer that has the bonus damage to a poisoned monster skill, bada boom, bada big bang, job's a good un. I will say from my time with the demo, hammer was a bit harder to use when I had Kana with me, and I know that buddy fighting will be regular throughout the game as a whole. It's just entirely built upon winning head-to-heads, so if the monster isn't attacking in a way that you can engage in a head-to-head, you can't do a whole lot with this weapon. It's a very risk-reward type of system. Hunting Horn.
Okay. There's a sword.
Fucking hell! Fuck!
My main from the main series monster hunting games. Both blunt weapons are sort of my thing, to be honest, but the hunting horn and its musical background just make me happy. In Stories 2, this is represented by your entire skill list being replaced with songs, and those songs changing entirely dependent on which hunting horn you have. Some of them increasing resistances, some counting as sonic bombs, and some increasing your affinity. And from the hunting horns that we have access to so far, my impression of the weapon is that it isn't really meant to be used as a main damage dealer for your party. Don't get me wrong, I'm sure that you can use it like that, and I am sure that there are horns out there with a sonic wave song or some equivalent that you can use to just pump out loads of extra damage each turn. But so far, all we have are songs that are long-term buffs and an instant sonic bomb. What makes the hunting horn work really, really well with the combat system in Stories 2, however, is the fact that we can now switch weapons mid-combat, and more importantly, the fact that hunting horn buffs stay applied even if you swap out weapons. So, let's say in one of your quick slots you have a hunting horn with an attack up song that lasts for 5 turns, that's a normal length of time in this game for buffs, and a crit up song that lasts for 5 turns as well. You take that hunting horn out, spend 1 turn doing the attack song, 1 turn doing the crit song, then you have 3 turns of full buffs to swap out to a different weapon and deal as much damage as physically possible with that weapon, in essence being used more as a buffing tool than as an actual weapon in itself. However, of course, if you brought it with you for that purpose, it could also be your proper blunt weapon to do blunt damage with when the need to do blunt damage arises. As far as the choice between this and the hammer, it is surprisingly similar to greatsword versus sword and shield. Hammer is slow and combo driven, requires the monster to hit you, which means you need time to pass to be as effective as possible. It also has the bonus of being able to do extra damage to monsters affected by statuses sometimes. Hunting Horn has a lower offensive ceiling from the equipment that we can currently see, but has the ability to support you and your entire teammate group, not only while it is out, but even after you switch to another weapon, which feels really strong in the long term, but would of course have to be paired with a weapon that doesn't need too much powering up, so you can continue swapping back and forth over and over. For that reason, I think Hunting Horn actually has a good amount of synergy with the sword and shield of the slashing weapons over the greatsword. Not that they can't be used together, but the on-demand nature of SNS just makes it fit the tight timelines of the hunting horn a little bit better. Bow. One of the first two weapons brand new to Stories 2, not even within Stories 1, this is the only proper ranged weapon in the game. Not that melee and ranged have the actual much meaning in an RTS game, but it's the principle of the thing. It feels great in this game. You actually feel like there is impact and weight to the concept of drawing arrows and preparing to fire. There are different shot types to choose from, which allow you to have a lot of variety in effectiveness per encounter based solely on the specific specific bow that you have equipped, and it just feels good. The loop is unique from any other weapon in the game, as you specifically have an ability called Charge, which lets you basically delay your turn to make your next turn stronger, allowing you access to your shot type attacks: Rapid Shot, which deals a load of single target damage, Spread, which hits all targets in front of you, or Pierce, which does a lot of specific part damage, and is a dragon piercer because why the hell not? As well, for bow, you also have a small chance at the end of the turn order to just do an extra shot, called a power shot. You just got it, because you do. Deal with it. It's not hard to explain why you would be interested in this weapon. It's a fantastic bow and arrow representation, and if you like the concept of archery, you'll probably enjoy playing this weapon. It is extra effective at applying statuses compared to most weapons, and as a result of that, I think there is a nice little synergy there with the hammer, which, as I mentioned earlier, can, on occasion, take advantage of abnormal statuses for extra damage. Gunlance.
Glock, 17 shots. Pen gun, mightier than the sword. Sword gun, mightier than the pen gun.
The other brand new weapon, a cannon on a stick with a slab of metal on the side. What more could you really need, honestly? This one is one of my favorite concepts from the main Monster Hunter series. It's literally just a lance and a shield, but the lance goes boom at the end just because it can. This is quite possibly the most complex weapon mechanically in this game, but in my opinion, also possibly the coolest from that side of things as well. First up, you do not gain passive kinship gauge just by attacking each turn, like you do with every other weapon. You still get some kinship from your Monstie attacking, but none from your Rider attacking. Instead, every turn, you gain one ammo passively. If you succeed in a head-to-head during your turn against the monster, you also gain one ammo, meaning that you can get multiple ammo per turn, depending on what happens. Then you have multiple skills, which cost zero kinship, but do cost ammo, and if you win a head-to-head using one of those skills, you will fill your kinship gauge massively. I'm talking nearly empty to full, almost on repeat, with the mid-tier ammo spender if you can really get those head-to-heads going and successful. This is a really satisfying gameplay loop. As if that wasn't enough, though, Gunlance has access to attack seals for a small amount of kinship, which, when used, give you a chance of blocking your opponent from using speed, power, or technical attacks, depending on which version you use. This won't always matter, but when it matters, it will really, really matter. There will be some fights that this will be an incredibly good skill for. As well, the Gunlance has a shield and thus has access to the guard skill, just the same as the sword and shield. And then finally, for a full 100 kinship, Gunlance gets to use Wyvern's Fire. Yes, I said 100 kinship, it empties your gauge entirely. According to the game, it is almost as strong as a kinship attack, though in my experience, it is probably somewhere around 60% of the power of a level 1 kinship attack, but it hits all of your opponents, as opposed to being a single target kinship attack. And of course, while you do this attack, your Monstie is free to attack as well that turn, which they simply wouldn't be otherwise if you were sitting on top of them giving them commands. Put simply, Gunlance has the most going on as far as actual things that you can take care of, options that you have, but it requires a fair bit of buildup, a fair bit of knowledge, and it definitely requires the ability to win head-to-heads often to use properly. But when used properly, oh man, this thing is going to be a load of fun. And that's all of them. All six of the weapons in Monster Hunter Stories 2. A bit of how they play and a mechanical overview. As far as groups of three of them, none of them scream out synergy quite hard enough to say those three belong together. Though, as I mentioned in the video, there are a couple of two weapon combos that make quite some sense to me. In general, it seems to me that you won't need to switch directly in the middle of a fight all the time. More so, just be comfortable with the three options that you have, so you're ready to bring out each damage option if you need it in a pinch. Personally, I have no idea what three are gonna follow me around yet. I assume sword and shield's gonna be my sharp one, because Josh would never let me walk around with a greatsword for a whole game, but as far as which blunt or which technical, I have no idea. They are all interesting and exciting to me in their own way. I can't wait to dive into them properly in the full game release, coming soon. Alright everyone, I haven't gotten Dinosaur, and which of these weapons in this game is your favorite so far? Which three do you plan on taking around with you? Like if you liked the video, subscribe and hit the notification bell for more, and most importantly, ladies and gentlemen, until next time, stay sweet. Josh, Cotton, and Hollow with the videos, dropping the humor like a hammer on your tippy toes, bringing entertainment on a daily arrangement to take our insanity and turn it into entertainment. Yes, I said entertainment twice, to reiterate that it is nice to look into your faces on a mostly daily basis when you let us in your homes to make the whole world a stage. Goodbye.